my help comes from, I know it comes from you. Oh, and when things get rough, I know just where to go. Hey, there's a peace when I get close to you.
Good afternoon and welcome to Spirit of New Ministries. I'm Pastor Charles Young. So glad to have you with me this afternoon as we go into our Bible study for the day. We are looking at a very, very important topic, and we're looking forward to getting started in just a moment after we begin with some prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for another glorious day, and we thank you for the opportunity to break open your word. We pray that you would speak to us, grant us wisdom and understanding, help us to apply your truth in ways that honor you and will be a blessing unto us. For that, O God, we give you our thanks and our praise, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, welcome. So good to have you with me this afternoon. We are in our second lesson on the topic entitled Blessed Obedience. We started our study last week, and we talked out of some of the Old Testament books in the beginning of the Bible, and we saw just what God's perspective is on obedience. Obedience is a topic that a lot of people don't like to talk about, but it's one that is absolutely necessary for us to get a good handle on, because obedience is really not that which causes us to lose anything in our relationship with Christ. But what it does is it helps us to gain. It helps to enhance our relationship with God, and therefore being able to live the life that God has destined and planned for us to live, a life of victory, a life of strength, a life of power. And so in our obedience, we walk in ways that honor God, and God honors those who honor him. And so tonight we're going to continue in our study, and just to give you a heads up, we're going to be focusing our attention tonight in the book of Psalms and in the book of Proverbs. We're also going to finish with the book of Ecclesiastes, but our focus tonight is going to be on two primary figures. We're going to be looking at King David and his son King Solomon. And as we look at those passages that have them as their authors, we're going to see just how God plants upon both of these significant Old Testament figures' hearts in order that we might gain a firm understanding of what being obedient to God is all about. Now, you know that both David and Solomon had a very rich history with God. They both had encountered trial, turmoil, and victories. And so as we look at both of these personalities, what we will see is how God has etched within their fabric of their character and their personality a need for obedience. They understood that this was something that was absolutely necessary. It was something that was a blessing to God. It was a blessing to them that God had allowed them to understand the necessity of obedience in their living. And so as we start tonight, we're going to begin in the book of Psalms, and we're going to look at the 111th Psalm, Psalm 111. We're going to consider verse 10. And what we're going to find out of this is that God, again, establishes a parameter for obedience, what it does, how God feels about it, and how we ought to govern ourselves accordingly. Psalm 111, verse 10, from the English Standard Version, there it reads, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever." I'll read that again, the fear of the Lord. And when we're talking about the fear of the Lord, those of you who've been with me, some of our studies, we've studied the fear of the Lord some time ago, and I explained to you that when you read the fear of the Lord, it's not a matter of cowering away or being afraid from a standpoint of terror, but the fear of the Lord is the honor of the Lord, or the humbling of oneself before God. Reverencing God and understanding him for who he is, and that he is God all by himself. He is the God who requires respect and requires honor. And so when we have a fear of the Lord, we have a reverencing of God. We honor him. We salute him and magnify him because he is worthy. And when we look at what it says there, the fear of the Lord is the beginning. It is the genesis, the starting of our wisdom. In order for us to be wise in our living, we have to have a starting place. And the starting place is to have a respect and a reverence for God. And in doing so, it brings us to the place where you come to the second portion of that 10th verse, where it says, all those who practice it. Now, that's where it's getting into the issue of obedience. When we practice having this fear of the Lord and walking in fear, in reverence, in honor, in respect, in salutation of the Lord, when we do this, it helps us to walk in ways that honor God. And in doing so, we're practicing it. We're walking in obedience. We're walking in what I like to call a surrendered posture before God. And God honors when his people walk in surrender to him. Surrender is the opposite of chaos and just doing what we want to do and just being who we want to be in spite of what God says. And so when we're walking in surrender, we're walking in a spirit of obedience, a spirit of righteousness. And doing so, God honors the person because he says, all those who practice it, all who walk in obedience, all who walk in surrender, in the fear of the Lord, he says, have a good understanding. And the scripture tells us that in all of our getting, we need to get understanding. And we get understanding so we know how to live. We know how to make the kinds of decisions that will help us to live a wholesome and a prosperous life before God. And so this whole process is one that we enter into understanding that we do it with a spirit of reverence before God. And that brings us to the place of walking in obedience. And therefore, we're able to praise him forever. The 112th Psalm, the very next Psalm, in the very first verse, there it reads, praise the Lord. Blessed is the man who fears the Lord, who greatly delights in his commandments. So there's a heart that a person has toward God, and that person who fears God and the person who delights in his commandments, not just to know what his commandments are, but to follow his commandments. And again, thereby the obedience by which we live. We live in obedience when we surrender to God's commandments, when we know what they are, when we fear God and have a spirit of surrender and reverence for God, and we walk in his commandments. Now, note that anytime the scripture tells us to obey the commandments of God or to live in the commandments, or as it says here, those who delight in his commandments, these are things that God tells us that we have the ability to achieve. God is never going to give us commands or to give us things that we need to do, ways that we need to live, and not equip us with the wherewithal to be able to accomplish it. Anything where it says in the scriptures where God tells us to live by his commandments or his testimony or his laws, he gives us the ability to do so that we can be successful in our living. It says the person who greatly does that delights in his commands, and God will bless that person. God wants to bless us. God has a heart's desire to bless his people. And when we walk in his ways and we delight in his commandments, God blesses his people. We move now to the next psalm, which is the 119th Psalm. All of these psalms were written by David. And there in Psalm 119 and the second verse, there it declares, blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart. Now, this passage is very, very significant because here it talks about not only are those who keep testimonies of God. And as I've told you before, anytime where you read where it says his testimonies, his laws, his commandments, his statutes, you'll see all of these different words that are referring to the very same thing, which are the word of God. When we keep God's word, when we read it, when we understand it, when we meditate on it, when we walk by it, when we live in it. All of these different references, whether it's commandments or testimonies or statutes, they're all referring to the Word of God. And it says, blessed are those who keep, and keep just means being obedient to these testimonies, being obedient to the Word of God, who seek Him after their whole heart. Now, just to take a moment and deal with seeking with our whole heart, that means pursuing God, going after God, recognizing what God's desire is in our lives and for our lives, and pursuing it with everything we have, with every ounce of energy that we have. We're going after it. We're not going to be denied. And we're going to pursue it with every ounce and every fiber of our being, because to pursue it means that God is honored in the midst of it. And so he says, who seek him with their whole heart. That means an earnest, a determinate spirit, that we are not going to fall backwards. We're not going to allow anything to get in our way, but we're going to go after this thing with everything in our being, because God is honored in the midst of that. When you also look at that 119th Psalm, and there are several passages out of this 119th Psalm we're going to look at, we're now going to drop down to verses 30 and 31. Psalm 119, verses 30 and 31. And again, I'm giving you these references so that you can have them for your benefit. So if you need to refer back to them, if you need to look at them and say, well, I need to see where the Bible tells me that obedience is a good thing. So when you look to 119th Psalm and verses 30 and 31, there it says, I have chosen the way of faithfulness. I set your rules before me. I cling to your testimonies. O Lord, let me not be put to shame. And so what we have here is a cause and effect. We have where David says, I've chosen to do the right thing. I've chosen the way of faithfulness. It's a choice. Again, God gives us the ability to do this, and it's his heart's desire that we walk in surrendered obedience to him. So David says, I have chosen the way of faithfulness. I set your rules before me. Now that's important, because when we set the rules of God before us, that means we always have them within our eyeshot. We keep them within our view. We keep them within our vision peripheral. And so in doing so, that keeps our mind focused on the Word of God. Here he talks about the faithful rules, those rules that he sets before him. Again, I said testimonies, statutes, all of these words mean the same thing. And so here he says, I set your rules before me. And then I cling to your testimonies. And David, again, is just talking about how his heart is just bent toward the things of God, how God honors it, how God desires it, and how he realizes in the very depths of his soul that this is a good thing. This is a thing that God is pleased with, and that God has equipped him with the capability of being able to accomplish. And in doing so, that cause and effect is that if we, when he does the things according to keeping his rules before him and making sure that he obeys these testimonies and he clings to them, there the end result says, let him not be put to shame. And beloved, that's why we need to study the Word of God, in order that we would show ourselves approved unto God, because a workman rightly dividing the word of truth need not be ashamed. When we stand on God's word, when we read God's word, that's why the scripture says we ought to meditate in God's word day and night. And in doing so, God will bless the person, the man, the woman of God, in order that God would be glorified and we, his people, would be blessed. Again, in that 119th Psalm, we're going to drop down to the 44th verse. This psalm is just packed with powerful, powerful passages that help us to understand the nature and the power and the necessity of standing boldly on and in God's word. The 44th verse, I will keep your law continually, forever and ever. And here, David demonstrates a determination, a very deliberate spirit, where he says, I will keep your law continually. He doesn't say, I'm going to keep it every now and again, just when it is convenient or just when it works for me, just when it seems to be a good idea, but he says, I will keep it continually. And again, you got to think about the life of David. David had a life that I would equate to a roller coaster ride. There were times when he was up, times when he was down, times when he was having good days, when he was having not so good days, days when he was living as the apple of God's eye, and then days when he was way out of bounds and he was living horrifically in sin. And David had a lot of different kinds of experiences with God, but all in all, he came to the realization that in spite of whatever his circumstances were, he needed to live in ways that were pleasing before God, which moved his heart, as he says in this 44th verse of the 119th Psalm. He says, I will keep your law continually forever and ever. And beloved, if we ever took on that kind of a mentality, if we ever decided, God, no matter what goes on, no matter what I find myself in the midst of, no matter what kind of circumstances I face, I am going to continually keep your law, and I'm going to do it forever and ever. God honors the person who has that spirit of determination. We see also in verses 59 and 60 of this 119th Psalm, there David again declares, he says, when I think on my ways, I turn my feet to your testimonies. I hasten and do not delay to keep your commandments. I really appreciate David, and I'm so thankful for how he expresses his spirit of determination to do the right thing. Now, all of us have days when things are just kind of clicking and we're moving in the spirit of God, and then we have some times when it seems like we're apart from God. Now, the thing we need to realize is that God never moves away from us. We're the ones who move away from God. But even in doing so, God is always right there. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. He never turns his back on us. So it's only a matter of us deliberating and understanding that God never moved. We're the ones who moved, and all we have to do to get back in right communication and right relation with him is to move back toward God. And that's why he says here, when I think on my ways, when I think of how there's been times when I've done good things, I've done things that were not so good, I've fallen away from God, I've gotten close to God, when I think on my ways, he says, I turn my feet toward your testimonies. Notice earlier he was talking about how he sets his rules before him. Now in these verses, he now talks about how he turns his feet to the testimonies of God. Now you know what that's indicative of? That means that he is determined to walk in the ways of God. He's determined. He's going to walk toward the things of kingdom. And he recognizes the importance of that, and he's now going to do it no matter what. He is determined. He is faithful. He's going to walk in the testimonies and walk toward the testimonies. He plans on keeping them. He plans on walking and living in obedience. And when he goes to verse 60, he says, I hasten, I hurry, I make every effort to do the right thing. And he says, I will not delay to keep your commandments. In other words, there's no hesitation. David decides beyond any shadow of a doubt that he's going to keep God's word. He's not going to delay. In other words, he doesn't have to think about it. He doesn't have to pray about it. Well, God, I know this is what your word says, but let me pray about it. No, there are things, and I've told you this many times before. Those of you who've been with me for a while, you know that I've told you over and over and over again, there are things that we don't have to pray about. There's a lot that we do need to pray about when we're asking for direction and we're asking for God's Spirit to give us wisdom and direction on some things. But then when it comes to the Word of God, when God's Word shows us and tells us and gives us very specific and very deliberate information about how we need to behave or things that we need to do, there's really nothing to pray about. It's just a matter of going into what the Word of God says and doing it. reading it, understanding it, praying that God gives us revelation, understanding, and then gives us obedience capability, which he always gives us the ability to do. We always have, by means of the Holy Spirit, we always have the ability, the capability of walking in obedience. And so there's nothing to pray about in terms of God. Do I need to obey your word? Yes, we need to obey his word. We don't, those are the kind of things we don't need to pray about, because we know beyond any doubt that we need to walk in obedience to the very word, the commandments, the rules, the statutes of God. And so that's why he says, I hasten and I do not delay to keep your commandments. Nothing to think about, nothing to pray about, nothing to deliberate over, but I will keep your commandments. I will walk in obedience. Praise be to God, to the man, the woman, the child of God who makes that deliberate determination that they're going to not hasten and walk in the ways of God. God honors that person, and God will rain blessings upon them. Psalm 119, now we're going to drop down to verses 100 through 102. Verse 100 says, I understand more than the aged, for I keep your precepts. I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep your word. I do not turn aside from your rules, for you have taught me. This is a deeper level of relationship and understanding that David is displaying here. He now says, I understand. He has grasped the principles and the precepts of God. He says, I understand more than those who've lived years beyond me. I understand more than people who are older than me, because God has deposited in him some things that he really need to grow up and learn. And there are times when, you know, I thank God for our senior saints and for how God has poured into them the benefits of living and the benefits of experience. But there are times when God will also pour those into younger people, because our hearts are pliable to the things of God. We're opening our heart to God. We're walking in the ways of God, and God honors that. And so David here recognizes when he says, I understand more than the aged, even more than those who may have lived longer than I have. He says, for I keep your precepts. Now, I need to just kind of mention this, because this is a key factor. God will enhance our understanding. He will understand. We will begin to understand more and more the more that we surrender in obedience. When I make myself obedient to the word of God, God then starts to pour into me information and precepts and understanding that I didn't have when I was walking in disobedience. And the reason why is because why would God enhance our understanding of the things of kingdom if I'm not going to walk in those things anyway? Why would God waste his time giving me understanding when my heart, mind, spirit, and soul is determined I'm not going to live by the things of God? I'm not going to walk by God's word. I'm not going to obey his statutes. I'm not going to live in his commandments. I'm not going to listen to his rules. Why would God give you more understanding if we've already made the decision I'm not going to walk in God's ways anyway? But when I make the decision that I'm going to walk in obedience, God, I surrender myself. I put myself at your altar, and I want to open my heart and my mind so that I can receive out of my meditation day and night on your word. Guess what? God starts depositing truth into our hearts, truth into our minds, into our spirits. He starts depositing wisdom so that now I'm able to understand those things that I could not understand when I was walking in disobedience. And that's why he says, I now keep your precepts, and because of that, I'm able to understand beyond my years. He goes on in verse 101, he says, I hold my feet back from every evil way. In other words, now he's talking about a whole nother level of his experience with God. He says, I'm going to now, because I understand some things, I'm going to exercise personal restraint over my life. I'm going to hold my feet back from the evil way. I'm going to do the right thing. And what that means is he not only makes the determination to do the right thing, but he also recognizes what the wrong thing is and makes the decision, the deliberate decision. He's not going to do the wrong thing, but he's going to do the right thing. Why? Because he's going to hold his feet back. In other words, he's not going to walk toward those things that are not pleasing before God, those things that are evil, those things that are sinful. He makes the decision. He knows what the wrong way is. He knows what the sinful way is, and he makes the decision he's not going to walk toward that. Now, the reason why I belabor that point is because there are so many people who have this attitude, well, I just can't help myself. I just kind of fell into it. Yes, you can help yourself because the Holy Spirit says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There is no reason why we cannot withhold ourselves from the things that are not pleasing, the things that are in direct opposition to God's word, those things that are contrary to kingdom. We have the ability. We have the capacity to not walk in those things that are not pleasing before God. And David says it right here. He says, I hold back my feet from every evil way. And what he is saying is that there is nothing that I don't have the ability to restrain myself from because I have the understanding of God's word because I continue to pursue the things of God. I really hope you get that because so many fall by the wayside because they kind of have this helpless mentality. Well, I just couldn't help myself. I got caught up. No, you don't have to get caught up. If you are a mature man or woman of God, you have the ability to not get caught up or to not just kind of fall into stuff because God has given us the ability to not do that. Just as David said, I hold my feet back. I make the decision not to go into sin. I make the decision not to walk in unrighteousness or unholiness. And then he goes on to say, not only do I hold my feet back from every evil way, but I do it so that I can keep your word. He said, I want to be obedient. I need to walk in obedience. My plan is to live in obedience, so I'm not going to go in the evil way, but I'm going to walk in the way of righteousness. And so David is giving us some very powerful bits of information as to how we can live in ways that honor God. And it takes away that argument or that myth that I just can't help it. I'm just kind of a victim of my circumstances or I'm a victim of my environment. No, you are not a victim of your environment. That is just a lie straight from the pit of hell. And you need to come against that right now in the name of Jesus. Because we do have the ability to walk in righteousness. He goes on and he says in verse 102, he says, I do not turn aside from your rules. He deliberately says, I do not turn aside, which means there is a willingness that he has deep within his bosom to do the right thing. I'm not going to turn aside from your rules. Why? Because you have taught me the right thing to do. Your word has instructed me. Your word has given me wise counsel. And so now I can walk in ways that honor you, in ways that are pleasing before you, so that now I can keep your statutes. That's that spirit of obedience. God, I'm going to do the right thing according to your word, not according to what the world says, not according to what friends or family may say, but according to what your statutes, your laws, your testimonies, your commandments. Going into the next passage, which is again in the 119th Psalm, we're going to now drop down to verse 112. There, David says, I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. And beloved, this is so, so, so very powerful because David decides in his heart. He said, I incline my heart. I position my heart. I posture my heart. I put my heart on notice that I'm going to perform your statutes, not just for a little while, not just on a temporary basis, but he says forever to the end. He says absolutely, resolutely, without any hesitation or exception, I'm going to live this thing out for the rest of my life. I have decided I am not going to turn back. I'm not going to turn aside. My heart is inclined to do the right thing, and I'm going to do it with my last breath. Beloved, that's that kind of obedience that God honors. That's the kind that he wants to see out of us on a daily basis. And that's the kind of obedience that we have the ability to live. Obedience is not just something we have to go out and try to grasp at, something that we just have to try to find on our own. We just kind of fend through the darkness trying to find it. But no, God gives us that ability by means of his Holy Spirit. Those of us who are Christians, we have the Holy Spirit inside of us. And the Holy Spirit enables us, gives us the ability to walk in ways that honor God. So I can obey God because the Holy Spirit gives me the capacity to do so. The final psalm that we want to look at is the 143rd psalm. In the 143rd psalm, verse 10, it reads, "Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. Teach me to do your will." What that says is David has put himself in a position where he is open to be taught. He's teachable. His heart is pliable before God. God can do something with him because he has set himself at the very feet and the throne of God. God, teach me. My heart's open, my mind's open, my spirit's open, my attitude is open. And when we approach the very throne of God with an open attitude, an open mind, an open spirit, God can do something, and he will do something. He says, "Teach me to do your will." He's fully exposed, fully open to the move of God in his life because he acknowledges God for who he is. He says, "For you are my God." He doesn't mince words. He's not confused. He is not double-minded in his mentality of who God is. He knows that God is his God. And because he does, he says, "God, teach me now. I'm ready to learn. Pour into me those things that I need to know so that I can walk in ways that honor you." He said, "Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. Keep me, Lord, focused on the things that I need to be focused on. Let your spirit give me direction. Let your spirit give me revelation. Let your spirit guide me wherever I go. Help me to stay on level ground." We're going to now look to the next grouping of passages. And there we're going to see King Solomon's saying regarding obedience. We just saw what the psalmist David had to say, Solomon's father. Now we're going to go to the next generation, King Solomon, David's son. And there's a few passages here that are really telling and really revealing. Proverbs, the 6th chapter, the 20th verse. Again, we're looking at the English Standard Version, Proverbs chapter 6, verse 20. Look at what he says. Solomon says, "My son, keep your father's commandment and forsake not your mother's teaching." Here, Solomon, he says, "Keep your father's commandments and forsake not your mother's teaching." Here, Solomon is very deliberate. Again, and I use that word deliberate. It means focused. It means determined. He said, "Keep your father's commandments." In other words, there were things that your father obeyed, those things of God. You need to incorporate them in your life. He says there ought to be a generational transfer. Those things that were pleasing before God that your father obeyed, you need to impart them in your own life. You need to allow them to take root in your own living. He says, keep your father's commandments. In other words, there were some good things that your father had. You need to incorporate those in our lives. And that's why it's so very important for the former generation to teach the next coming generation. Each generation has a responsibility to sow into the next coming generation. That's a biblical principle that we see all throughout Scripture. There is a generational transfer that we have the responsibility of adhering to. Number one, so that we in our current generation can look back to the good things of God, look back to the commandments, to the statutes that our parents adhered to, apply them to our living. Because if it was good for them, it's good for us. If it's good for us, it'll be good for our next coming generation, for our offspring and our offspring's offspring. And so that generational transfer is what's pleasing before God. Now, I need to just mention something here, that when we talk about generational transfer, the initial generation has the responsibility of sowing down to the next generation through counsel, through teaching, through declaration, through testimony, through whatever it takes in order for the first generation to explain to that next coming generation the things of God. That is the responsibility. It is also the responsibility of the next generation to receive those things that the former generation is trying to sow. So there is a capture that needs to happen. There is a transfer. Once one generation gives over to the next generation, it's up to that next generation to receive and embrace and apply that truth. And that's the only way that we're going to be able to walk consistently, generationally, with respect to the Word of God. You look at our society today, much of what is going on in terms of the chaos and in terms of all of the violence is because there's not been a generational transfer. There's not been a transfer from one generation to the next generation, the good things, the holy things, the righteous things, the godly things that we need to honor. And therefore, the next generation, they're not receiving it. If the first generation doesn't give it, the next generation is not going to receive it. And that's why that generational transfer is so very, very vital. He goes on and he says, do not forsake your mother's teaching. Your father's commandments you need to keep, but you need not forsake your mother's teaching. And what that really reveals is that it's a parental responsibility to teach our children. It is an absolute. It is not something that we whimsically decide we don't want to do. But if we call ourselves children of God, if we call ourselves Christians, it is our responsibility to sow to our children. And it's our responsibility to do it on a consistent basis. Now, by nature of the fact that it's a parental responsibility to sow to the next generation, it is the children's responsibility to receive those things from the parents. And so here, Solomon says, keep your father's commandments, forsake not your mother's teaching. When you look at the next passage in Proverbs, the 10th chapter, and now we go to verse 8. Verse 8, Solomon declares, the wise of heart will receive commandments, but a babbling fool will come to ruin. And here we have this information that Solomon reveals about the heart of a wise person will receive commandments. In other words, a person who has a wise heart, who walks in wisdom, lives in wisdom, will also receive God's commandments, which means he will walk in obedience. On the flip side, it says that a babbling fool will come to ruin, meaning that person who does not receive God's commandments, that person who does not accept the word of God, will not receive the statutes of God, will not walk in obedience. That person that just kind of does what they want to do, they give themselves to every wind of doctrine that kind of floats around, and they're just kind of blowing with the wind, and they're just doing their own thing, and they're not adhering to the statutes, the commandments, the rules, and the commandments of God. And he says that person is a babbling fool, and that person will come to ruin. It is an absolute. Just as how the person who adheres to the word of God will walk in the blessedness of God, the person who rejects the commandments of God, who will not adhere to the word of God, that person is likened to a babbling fool. They're talking crazy. And the eventuality is that they are going to come to ruin. Proverb chapter 16, verse 7. That passage says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. That is so powerful. That when a person's ways please God, in other words, when we walk in surrendered obedience, God can even turn your enemies to be your friends. God can cause your enemies, those people who come at you, those people who have no good thing to say about you, God has a way of quieting their mouths and staying their efforts against you, to where now your enemies can't even do anything. He prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemies. And that reveals how God is able to put us in a place of peace, even in the midst of those who would do us harm. He goes on in the 19th proverb, the 16th verse. And there Solomon says, whoever keeps the commandment keeps his life. He who despises his ways will die. Beloved, this is so next level. And what I mean by that is, for us to really embrace this and understand it is really the difference between life and death. Here, whoever keeps the commandments keeps his life. And what this passage is revealing and what it's really demonstrating is that the keeping of God's commandments are directly related to living and long life and staying alive. Now, does that mean that the person who keeps God's commandments is automatically going to live a long life? Does it mean that there can't be a tragedy that might happen that might cut a person's life short? Yes, we live in a sin-darkened and a sin-fallen world. And so, yes, tragedy happens to a lot of people, even those who keep the commandments of God. But by and large, God honors the person who honors him. And part of that honor is allowing a person to keep their life. When we walk in the commandments of God, we have a greater opportunity and a greater likelihood of living and living longer and living better. Whereas when we adhere to the things of God, God blesses us. When we make the deliberate decision, the determination, I'm not going to adhere to God's word, I'm going to walk in direct opposition to God's word, it brings death. Death is more likely. Death, there's a greater chance of us not living long because we're walking in ways that are demonic. We're walking in ways that are satanic because we're not walking in the ways of God. And what God does is he brings the hedge down so that now we're exposed. When we're walking in the ways of God, God raises up his hedge of protection, and he allows us to walk in protectiveness. He allows us to walk in peace. He allows us to walk in the righteousness of God, and therefore he protects us. But when we decide, I'm not going to live according to the word of God, I'm not trying to hear God's word, I don't want to do what's right, what God does is he allows the hedge to come down. And then we're exposed to every demonic and every satanic force that's out there. And we know what Satan wants. We know what his desire is. We know what his plan is. His plan is to kill, steal, and destroy. And that's why it is so critical. As he says in the 16th verse, whoever keeps the commandments, keep his life. He who despises his ways will die. Our final passage for the evening is out of Solomon's writings of the Ecclesiastes. In Ecclesiastes, the 12th chapter and the 13th verse, it sums it up like this. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. The end of the matter, when all is said and done, at the end of the day, when the dust settles, however you want to put it, when all things come to fruition, he said, all has been heard. The bottom line is to fear God, as I mentioned a little earlier, to reverence God, to have a healthy respect to the things of God. When we reverence, when we fear God, keep his commandments, and there is obedience. Be obedient to the things of God. Keep his commandments. And Solomon concludes by saying, for this is the whole duty of man. That's why we're here. We're here to fear God and to obey his commandments, because this is the whole duty. This is the whole reason why we are here. Beloved, this concludes our lesson for the evening as we've studied the words of David's out of the Psalm, and we've looked at Solomon's sayings out of Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. I pray that this has been a help for you. I pray that you're able to grow from this and to apply these principles for your living, so that you can not only walk in obedience, but that you can also walk in the very blessedness of our God. We're going to have a word of prayer as we close our lesson for the evening. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come tonight to the close of our lesson, we pray that your word would sink deep into our hearts. We pray that you would enhance our understanding, enlighten our wisdom, and help us, Lord, to walk in ways that please you. Help us to walk in obedience. Help us to walk in a surrendered posture, that you would be pleased, you would be glorified, and we as your people would be blessed. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your spirit who helps us to understand your word. Help us to live it and to love it and to do so to your pleasure. For that, we offer our thanks. We offer our praise. And it's this prayer that we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, thank you so much for joining me here at Spirit of New Ministries. I'm Pastor Charles Young. I look forward to seeing you next Wednesday. And even before then, on this coming Sunday, please feel free to join us here at Spirit of New Ministries at 10:15 for our live stream and our worship. We look forward to having you with us. Again, God bless you, and we'll see you next time here at Spirit of New Ministries.